As we said earlier, the government reported the lowest unemployment rate of the decade today, 6.1%. That improvement comes at a time when some workers are saving jobs by owning their own workplace. Plants around the country are being sold to workers instead of closing down. Employee ownership has even become a buzzword among Democratic presidential candidates who view it as a way to preserve jobs in industrial America. Our special business correspondent, Paul Solman, has an example.
This is the General Dynamics shipyard in Quincy, Massachusetts. After more than 100 years in business, this yard now sits idle. But former workers have hatched a plan to revive this place. They're part of an offer to buy the yard from General Dynamics. And if the company accepts their offer, then overnight, this yard will become one of the largest worker-owned enterprises in America. For almost 2 years, the former workers have been meeting daily to keep alive a plan they say is going to work.
It's going to work because people got hope. Hope that this yard will open, stay open, and not for a year, not for 2 years, but it'll stay open for another 100 years.
The workers hope to get their jobs back, but they're taking a real risk because the yard may never reopen, and even if it does, it may never make money. Some left-wing advocates of worker ownership call the current buyout wave lemon socialism. The sale of an unprofitable operation, a lemon, to its workers, the only people desperate enough to want it. But the workers argue that the incentive of ownership will make the yard profitable.
Under a worker ownership, you would take pride in anything you built, knowing it was yours. You're the company. You're the whole thing.
So employees may work harder, pay themselves less for a while, anything to keep the company alive. If it's a real lemon, of course, increased efficiency may not be enough to save it. But here in Quincy, the union group contends that this shipyard wasn't unprofitable so much as incompetently managed.
That they're trying to get people to wildcat so they can shut down this yard and blame the union and blame the workers instead of their mismanagement.
Indeed, General Dynamics has a rather impressive recent history of cost overruns, shabby accounting, and ineffectual labor relations. So when the company announced it was closing the yard, the union had reason to think it could do better.
Keep Quincy strong! We need a shipyard in Quincy!
In late 1985, an economic feasibility study found that if labor costs were trimmed, operations cut back, and some of the yard put to other uses, Quincy could reopen, so long as a new management team could be brought in, a management team that could work hand-in-hand with the old union.
How long has it been, Squeaky, since you've been out of the yard?
Peter Gwynn, a former manager here who fought the union in the 1970s, was chosen to lead the worker buyout because Gwynn now believes in worker ownership.
We've had people come in here and offer to buy the shipyard and put the workers back to work. But we, that is myself and the workers, know that it's going to degenerate back to the same thing it was before, with a boss sitting up there and workers sitting down there. Never the two meeting, productivity going to hell, costs rising, not meeting budgets, and back on the street again in 2 years.
To avoid that outcome, Peter Gwynn and his union partners are proposing worker ownership with full worker control. To the workers here in Quincy, it seems almost obvious. If you own something, you should get to control it. But amazingly, of the 7,000 or so firms in America with significant worker ownership, no more than two dozen are democratically controlled by their workers. Why the disparity between ownership and control? Largely because of a government program called an Employee Stock Ownership Plan, an ESOP, or ESOP. In an ESOP, the corporation gets a major tax break if the employees purchase stock in the company. But an ESOP leaves control firmly in the hands of management. The problem is that ownership without control can lead workers back into the same old antagonistic relationship to management that helped get the company in trouble in the first place. Consider, for example, the widely publicized case of New Jersey's Hyatt Clark Industries. Hyatt Clark was featured 5 years ago on the PBS business series Enterprise.
In order to save their company, these two militant union leaders convinced their fellow employees to buy it.
At Hyatt Clark, the lawyer who put together the buyout and became chairman of the board didn't trust the workers to have control over management.
I'm not satisfied, and I think the union leadership and most of the hourly paid employees would agree,
that they have the experience or the knowledge to participate at all levels of management decisions.
The workers at Hyatt Clark, on the other hand, had taken a 25% wage cut, and in return, they expected some real power.
I think in each and every aspect of the decision-making policy of the company that we should be involved in, because we've made the sacrifices, and we've said that we're going to make sacrifices, but we're going to make this thing go, but we want to be heard.
The Enterprise documentary recorded a key meeting at which an industrial psychologist tried to mediate between workers and management.
You started out with an announcement this plant was going to shut down, and a lot of uncertainty and insecurity. We're going to have jobs, we're going to have a plant, whatever.
But without true partnership, the patterns of the past repeated themselves, as the managers made clear when they caucused privately.
I see them to be very sensitive to any reactions or criticisms. Is that saying it?
Meanwhile, at the worker caucus, there was the traditional blue-collar resentment of management.
They see this as adversaries, and that's the way it's supposed to be. We're the union, they're the company.
No, it's not supposed to be that way. We're now an employee-owned company, so we shouldn't be adversaries.
As long as you're the union. Well,
as long as you're union, you shouldn't see us as adversaries, because if we want to run this plant on an equal basis, there's no reason why we should be fighting each other.
Back together, the workers expressed their sense of powerlessness.
I see all these things you got written up on a wall, and it don't mean totally shit to me. Relationship and everything else, Pat.
We're trying to tell you how we see you. If it doesn't mean anything to you, that's for you to evaluate.
Well, that's where our problem is, Pat, because we don't see everything eye to eye. Well, and basically, are we owners or what are we doing? Adversaries? You guys, I told you guys before, we're adversaries. Well, we're basically owners in this place.
It was only a matter of time before this experiment collapsed, with the workers actually staging a slowdown at the firm they owned. Several weeks ago, Hyatt Clark announced it would be shutting down for good this summer.
The reasons that companies have failed often have had to do with the way in which the plan was written, the way in which workers either had or did not have real rights and control over their company.
As one of the country's foremost consultants on worker buyouts, Chris Mackin watched the Hyatt Clark disaster up close and is now consulting to the shipyard workers here in Quincy. In both cases, a traditional blue-collar union was faced with breaking the bad habits of a militant past.
The examples that haven't worked are really examples of disillusionment and frustration on the part of workers, that they thought they were going to have a say, they thought they were going to be treated differently, and they weren't.
If the buyout is to work here in Quincy, Mackin and others believe it will have to be run democratically.
The Hyde Clark in New Jersey, where the managers got bonuses and the rest of the profit went to buying new equipment. No raises to the workforce whatsoever, which is clearly the wrong thing to do.
We're going to make sure that that's not ever going to happen with the workers here at the Quincy shipyard. It's going to be an employee's buyout. Each one is going to have a share. Each one is going to have a say in who the directors are going to be, and we're going to be looking out for each other.
But for all its advantages, democracy can also be a very difficult system to operate under. Observers such as Chris Mackin think that this new form of industrial organization requires a new attitude from workers, and particularly from their managers.
It's going to take a breed of management people who do see their job as something more than making money, who do want to work alongside people and make a commitment for the long haul, and who do see management as a service profession, if you will, of working with, serving the people who you're working for.
If General Dynamics does sell to the worker group, then the issues here will be those facing any worker buyout. Are workers and managers actually able to be that much more efficient just because each owns a piece of the business? Or is industrial democracy more likely to lead to corporate chaos and collapse? A lot of people will be watching the Quincy shipyard to see what happens if the deal does go through, and to see if one old militant union can prove, in at least this case, that workers are actually more efficient sometimes when they get the bosses off their backs.